From the City of Angels off the Pacific Ocean, good morning, good evening, wherever you may be across the nation, around the world. I'm George Norrie, and welcome to Coast AM. First of all, happy Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, for those of you of the Jewish faith. And if you're into the supernatural, you're going to enjoy this hour. Stevenson Doney grew up on the streets of New York City and was surrounded by people of many backgrounds, ethnicities. This aroused some curiosity about the human condition and a need to understand, hey, what makes people choose the paths that they go down? Such is the case when he came across the legend of J.C. Brown. We'll talk about that. The man who claimed to have discovered a lost city in Shasta Mountain and hidden treasure and remnants of a legendary society. Here's Stephen on Coast to Coast. What an exciting story, Stephen. How are you?
Very good, George. It's been a long time since we've spoken.
Yes.
It's a pleasure to be on with you again.
You were with me about 4 years ago, I think.
That is correct. I was with you on April 18, 2008, to be correct.
Well, good to have you back. For a lot of people who are brand new to this show, Stephen, tell us a little bit about the legend of J.C. Brown.
Okay, the legend of J.C. Brown is about, it's a baffling story about a man who shows up in Stockton, California in 1934 at the age of about 67, and he goes into the office of the editor of the Stockton Record newspaper, and he spins a tale about a lost treasure that he said he had found 30 years earlier while employed with the Lord Cowdray Mining Company of England, approximately 1903 and 1904. And the editor of the paper gets him in touch with John Root, who becomes the organizer of a group. They also get the curator of a museum, Harry Noyes Pratt, of the Hagen Museum in Stockton. And for 6 weeks, they hold meetings twice a day. And J.C. Brown claims that while prospecting, he had come across an unusual rock basalt formation, and upon his second trip up to the Cascade Mountain Range, he dug it out, and whereupon, after going into this tunnel that he found, 3 miles into it, there was mined ore and gold there that he saw from a prehistoric type of race, and as they went further, 8 miles further into this mine-type shaft, he came across a city, as he called it, where he found a skeleton 6.5 to 10 feet tall. He found mummified remains of a king and queen, he believed, from Lemuria. And he found hieroglyphics that showed an ancient culture. And what he wanted was these 80 people that had assembled in 1934 to accompany him up to Mount Shasta at his expense. And what he said, there was two caves that he found, other than the one he was talking about, and that in the two caves that he would give the collections of what was found there to the 80 people that went up on the expedition, but the other cave where the mummified king and queen remains were, he wanted to keep intact for the museums. So on the morning of May of 1934, when the 80 people were supposed to leave from Stockton, California with J.C. Brown, he mysteriously disappeared.
Oh, really? So you started your own investigation into this. Did you find anything a little different than the myth?
Oh, absolutely, I did. When I first read it, I read it in the Emily A. Frank book, Mount Shasta, California's Mystic Mountain. There's only 3 pages in there, but I said I'm going to spend a couple weeks at a New York Public Library at the time and just to see if I could research this to find out what I could, because I was looking for a screenplay to write. And so I spent a couple weeks. The first thing I did is I said, well, was there a Lord Cowdray? You know, because in the legend is the Lord Cowdray Mining Company. So
right.
As funny as it sounds, I just Googled Lord Cowdray Mining Company. All of a sudden, bullseye, I found out that there was a Lord Cowdray Mining Company.
It pops up, huh?
So it pops up. So I'm looking further. I says, who is this Lord Cowdray? And this was the tough part because what I found out later that Lord Cowdray was a name that was given afterwards to Sir Wheatman Pearson, who was knighted in 1916 and was given the title of Viscount Cowdray in England. So I thought, well, let me look at the age of this man. And he was an older man at the time, but in 1934— one of the stumbling blocks I came across was that Lord Carriageway had died, or Sir Wheatman Pearson had died in 1927, so he could not be the man who showed up in the Stockton Record of 1934. So I reread the legend, and it said the man said he was a lieutenant for many years with the Lord Carriageway Mining Company. So I went to a different library in New York, and I was able to find the memoirs of Sir Wheatman Pearson, Lord Carriageway. And in the book, there happened to be pictures of three other civil engineers. And I'm looking at the other three. So I said, you know what, let me go back to the library in 34th Street mm-hmm. and look through all the border crossings and see if I can match up the other three names of the civil engineers with Sir Wheatman Pearson or Lord Carriageway coming across either in through Mexico, through New York, Canada, or any border crossings coming into the United States, because 80, 90 years ago, our country was pretty much anal retentive with records, like who's coming in the country. Nobody could really sneak in. So there were records at that time. So I said, well, if that be the case, I'm looking for specifics now, 1903, 1904, in that area, as the legend states. And now that I know that Lord Carriageway was really Sir Wheatman Pearson, let me look at him and other men who are in this civil engineer's memoir for Sir Wheatman Pearson. So I did, and lo and behold, one of the men's name in the photo that I had was John Benjamin Boddy, of the three men that were in there in Sir Wheatman Pearson's memoirs. I noticed that John Benjamin Boddy started making crossings into the United States through Laredo, Texas, as early as 1903. And then I noticed that coming through, he had come in with Lord Carriageway or Sir Wheatman Pearson in 1904 with other men that were engineers of the Lord Carriageway Mining Company.
So
upon further inspection, I noticed that there was about three or four instances where Lord Carriageway, Sir Wheatman Pearson himself came in with J.B. Boddy. But J.B. Boddy had come in through Mexico possibly up to 18 times in a 15-year period. But what was interesting, George, was that in the third or the fourth time John Benjamin Boddy was coming through, on the manifest records, when asked if he had ever been in the United States, he lied and said no.
Wow. Why would he do that?
Well, the reason why I believe he did that, though, is because going up to Mount Shasta and coming back, he had to cross the border. And some of the artifacts that he had gathered underneath the mountain, he had to be very, very careful as to what he took back over the border into Mexico, because he was working for the Lord Carriageway Mining Company in Mexico. And here was a man who was building the Tehuantepec Railroad, which connected the Pacific side of Mexico to the Gulf. And what they did was, when the goods from China would come to the United States, they would come through to Mexico, come across on that Tehuantepec Railroad, and they beat the United States to the Panama Canal by 12 years. So this was a major deal for the Pearson Company or the Lord Carriageway Mining Company, because they were closely related or in business with Porfirio Diaz, the president of Mexico.
So he had to hide some of these artifacts, you're basically saying.
Exactly.
All right. Now, this tunnel, this long, long tunnel, so it's very possible the things he says that he found, these skeletons and everything else, might be real.
Exactly.
Did anybody else find it? I mean, have you seen it? Is it out there? What's, now, there's got to be something mystical about this.
Yes, there is. And here's the mystical part of it. After I was on your show, I decided to go out to California to actually find these doors that that lead into the bowels of Mount Shasta. Upon doing so, someone had sent me an email about a man who was hiking in that area, and him and his daughter was on Thanksgiving of 2008. So I was on your show in April. But in November of 2008, this gentleman, while walking with his daughter, had come across this rock formation.
Mm-hmm.
And out of nowhere, a 7-foot man with a white robe appeared and spoke with a British accent and invited them in and told them they had just found the back entrance to Telos.
Which was the back entrance of the front entrance of this tunnel, right?
Yes.
Okay. So way on the other side.
So now this man and his daughter had the choice of going in or not going in. Well, This tall figure, probably ominous figure, scared the bejesus out of both of them, so they declined.
That's probably smart.
Now, this man, his grandfather, Levi Van Fossen, owned the property by Hedge Creek Falls and Mossbrae Falls about 100 years ago. So this property that this man was walking on was once owned by his relatives. Afterwards, he put this story on the internet, and I contacted him, and he validated that, yes, this did happen. So I figured I'd wait until I was actually had more information, knew exactly where it was, and I figured out how it was done. And what happened was Lord Cowdray and Sir Wheatman Pierce, who was Sir Wheatman Pearson, brought with him John Benjamin Boddy, who was the J.C. Brown of the legend, and other engineers up to the Shasta Springs Resort. And they were there on vacation. And Shasta Springs was an elite resort where you could drink the Shasta water. It was bubbling spring water that they had on the property, which came from the mountain itself. So the lava tubes go from the mountain onto this property. Mm-hmm. So this was an elite property. They would get off the train in Dunsmuir, take a tram up to the property, and they would spend their vacation hobnobbing with the rich and famous. These were all very rich, prominent men. So while they were on this property, they came across this unusual basalt rock formation, and being all civil engineers, decided to dig it out. And on consecutive trips, J.B. Boddy kept coming back and back and back, request of his boss, Sir Wheatman Pearson, Lord Cowdray, to dig this out for the artifacts. But John Benjamin Boddy waited until after Sir Wheatman Pearson died.
Okay, hold on for a second, Stephen. We're going to take this quick break. We're going to come back in just a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Stephen's website is hooked up at coasttocoastam.com. We'll get into what the heck is going on at Mount Shasta, and we'll take some phone calls. If you live in that area up that way, if you've ever been there, check in with us, or we'll take your questions. We'll be right back.